Shalom, Mishpucha. Shalom, family. Mishpucha is a Hebrew word, means family. We're the Mishpucha, the family with a Jewish heart, made up of Jewish and non-Jewish people. We're the middle wall of separation between Jew and Gentile, finally come down to form one new man. And in the Greek, one new humanity. Getting ready, Mishpucha, to blow the grandest shofar, the grandest trumpet in Zion. We want everyone everywhere to hear the good news. We want everyone everywhere to be red hot for the Messiah. Now, my guest is Lisa Bevere. Many of you are familiar with her because she's teaching on television all over the place. And you're also familiar with her husband, John Bevere. He's a world-class teacher. Now, I don't know, Lisa, I kind of protest. Why would God put two world-class teachers together? Only one of you should have been.
You know, I really think God is trying to model what he began with, that he had one man, one woman with one heart who raised one voice in their unique strengths, so they could speak to what God wants to do in this generation.
I want people to get to know you. I want to get to know you a little bit better. I have some notes here, but I found out something about you that I wasn't even aware of. You had an eating disorder even before you became a believer for something like 6 years. Was it irritable bowel syndrome? Was that what you were dealing with?
You know, I had a number of things. I had an eating disorder. I had anorexia, bulimia, and then I had lactose intolerance, and I had irritable bowel syndrome. I had all of those mixed together.
And I know people with just the irritable bowel syndrome, and that's such a devastating thing. I mean, it wrecks their whole life.
Mm-hmm. I had been hospitalized because of having extreme stomach problems for 3 days, actually just a few weeks before I met John. Now, I was a complete heathen. I was just doing that whole passionate, fallen world things, drinking, being wild. And it came into me, actually, when I was in the hospital, I said, there has got to be something more. There has got to be something more to this life. I thought this was going to be fun. It actually now feels empty. And Sid, I don't know if you know this, but John actually led me to the Lord. He shared about Jesus with me on our very first date. And he joined hands with me, and he prayed for me. He said, you know, now you're saved. And I was like, what does that mean? And he said, it means to be whole again, spirit, soul, and body. And when he said that, having absolutely no idea that he was talking to a broken girl, a girl that had just compromised every area of her life and had an incredible battle with eating disorders and stomach pain and lactose intolerance, I just looked at him and I said, oh, so I can have cheese now? And he was like, what? And I said, you just said that God was going to heal me, and I cannot have cheese. I have lactose intolerance. I'm so excited. He was so panicked that he was like, oh, my gosh. So he took my hand. We were 21 and 22 years of age, and he said, all right, Jesus, if you can save her, you can heal her. And he had me repeat, you know, God, I just thank you for healing me of, and then I said lactose intolerance, stomach problems, and in Jesus' name. And I felt the warmth of God come into my stomach and untie knots that had been in my stomach since I was 15 years of age.
Had you ever felt that presence of God in your entire life previously?
You know, I had felt it one time when I was about 5 years old, but no, not other than that.
What happened when you were five?
Well, I lost an eye to cancer when I was five, and it was interesting. Right before they discovered that I had cancer in my retinoblastoma, I actually had a night vision, and I had been praying as a little girl. I had such a desire to honor God with my life, but had absolutely no idea what that would look like, and I had been praying in my bedroom when a presence of light came into my room. It was like a shaft of light made out of stone. I know that doesn't necessarily make sense. And it had Hebrew writing on it. And the peace of God and the presence of God came into my room. And I have to tell you, as a little girl, for some reason, that presence of light and God saying that there was in my little girl mind something already written about me gave me the assurance that I would live and not die. And so when they gave my parents 6 months for me to live, and I am now 54, so I obviously did not die, I had such an awareness that God had already visited me and his hand was on my life for something, but I had absolutely no idea what that would look like.
Now, when you were young and this happened, when you had cancer in your eye, I'm told that the light was so bright.
Yes.
People could see it outside your door, but there was no light on.
Right. My babysitter came running in, and she was yelling as she came down the hall, "I told you to turn off your lights." And she opened up the door, and it was complete darkness, and absolutely freaked her out. And she actually would never, ever babysit for me again. So it's very, very, very strong presence of God. This would be back in 1965. So I don't know if she was part of the drug culture and it freaked her out. But, yeah, no, it was very very poignant, very pointed. It's something I can go back in my life and mark. And I do believe that God wants to speak to his people in dreams and in visions.
Okay. We John prays for you. He leads you to the Lord. You say, I got all these conditions. It's a wonder he didn't walk out right there. But just a simple childlike prayer, that same presence you felt as a young girl came upon you again. How long did it take with all these conditions? You were addicted to diuretics and laxatives and the stomach disorder and the irritable bowel syndrome. You were running a fever. You had rashes. You were in constant discomfort. I mean, it was a horrible way to live. How long did it take God to heal you?
Well, I immediately healed my body, but you know what? It took time for me to change my practices, to understand that I could actually entrust him with my weight. I mean, Sid, it's interesting. People do not realize that anything and everything that is important to us is important to God. And so I kind of thought, okay, now I'm a Christian, so my weight, that's not important to God. I just need to navigate. That needs to be something I navigate on my own. And I think I had been saved for about a year and a half. And, you know, what's interesting is when you have an addictive personality, which is definitely what I had and I still have, I'm addicted to Jesus, and that's what I'm going to just have to be addicted to for the rest of my life. But when I had substituted drinking, I was like, okay, I need to stop getting drunk. I switched my addictive behavior to overeating. So I was underweight when I got saved. Then I became overweight when I became a Christian, because Christians, oh my goodness, they don't drink, but they eat excessively. And so I switched my drinking excessively to an eating excessively. And then I remember God saying, listen, if you will stop weighing yourself, if you will stop dieting, and if you will give this to me, I am going to perfect those things that concern you. You can trust me with this. I had gained so much weight that I couldn't get into my wedding gown. I was, we were supposed to be getting married about 4 weeks later, and I could not get into my wedding gown. And he said, Lisa, a diet changes the way you look, but a fast changes the way you see. And he said, I need you to see everything differently. I need you to see yourself differently. I need you to see me differently. I need you to see everything about food differently. And he said, a diet, he said, is about denying yourself, but a fast is about indulging me. And he said, I need you to give me room in your life. I need you to let me be your banquet. And so, Sid, I went from eating until I was uncomfortable to eating till I was satisfied. And I actually had to have the Holy Spirit teach me that. And I offered up my food with prayer and thanksgiving and said, God, you know what? You show me. You show me, because I had lost all sensitivity to what it meant to be satisfied. I only knew what it meant to be in pain. And so God actually gave me a weight. And I know a lot of people out there, you're thinking, what? God wants to be, absolutely, he wants to be involved in this area of your life. He wants to be intimately involved in your most intimate areas of your life. But God actually gave me a number, Sid, and I remember I wrote it down on a piece of paper and I shoved it in my Bible, and he said, I'm the one who made you. Not shape, not glamour, not Vogue, not women's health, not men's fitness. I'm the one that made you, and I am the one who knows what you should weigh. And he gave me this number. And I remember I stuck it in my Bible, and I stopped dieting, and I just began to walk with God. I began to worship. I began to build back strength and not look at myself the way I'd seen myself before. And do you know, on my wedding day, I weighed that exact number, and I have pretty much stayed that exact wait for 32 years.
Explain to me what God meant when he said to you, your weight has become an idol.
Well, okay, so I love that most people don't think about idols as something that we would have today, but they really are truly everywhere we go. I mean, an idol is something that we give our strength to and draw our strength from. So for me, my example would be if I felt thin, then I felt worthy. I felt confident. I felt like I could witness to people. I felt like I deserved love. And so my weight became something I bowed down to because it controlled my life. You know, it controlled the way I felt about myself. It controlled the way I approached scriptures. It controlled how I approached other people. And see, God doesn't want us to raise up any image or any idol above what he wants to have in our life. And the truth is, when we begin to see ourselves the way God sees us, then we begin to live the way we are made. I love how Isaiah says, he will teach us to live how we were made. We're a people that were made for God. And so when we go to idols, they don't teach us to live the way we are made. And you know, everything with women right now, you know, is on a magazine cover, and it says, if you want to be loved, you have to be bikini ready by May. You know, it's got all of this stuff out there. And it's also telling women that if they want to have some kind of worth, they have to be sexually desirable. And there is a huge idol in this nation of our self-image, of our body images. And the truth is that we can actually trust God with that. And he will change things. And I believe the way we eat is also driven by the way we look at ourselves. And so if I'm thinking that food is my source, if food is my comfort, it's an idol. But if I understand that food is something good that God gave me, I'm going to eat with a different attitude.
Lisa, that made a major change in your life. But there was something else that caused a major change in